I spoke with the WBC Super Featherweight Champion, Eva Walsh, from via Instagram, and I asked her, you know, who's next? Who should we expect to see her fighting next? And Eva Walsh communicated that Top Rank had promised her a defense against Michaela Mayer at the beginning of next year. And if by some chance that doesn't work out, they're also hoping for Eddie Hearn to make the fight with Terry Harper. Now, before any of this should come to pass early next year, Eva Wahlstrom also informed me that she will be participating in an 8-rounder. Before the year is out, she's going to have a little tune-up fight, little gimme fight. I mean, that's the inference you can make, her being a world champion participating in what is an 8-rounder. I don't imagine they're going to match her against some tough out, some kind of killer in the super featherweight division.
Not yet.
So, you know, what do I think about all this? You know, I have to say this, because Eva Wahlstrom, I feel, is a fighter that's gotten a bad rap. She's gotten a bad rap due to some close calls, some close fights, and some hard feelings coming from those fighters. You know, Melissa St. Ville being very vocal that she feels that she was robbed. The Ronika Jeffrey fight being as close as it was, and how some people felt that Ronika had done enough to win the fight. You know, ahead of that fight, I warned that Ronika Jeffrey, that's not an easy out, that if Eva Wahlstrom really were in the business of avoiding tough fights, she wouldn't have been fighting Ronika Jeffrey in the first place. So this idea that Eva is protected, or that, you know, she tries to circumvent tough fights, it's preposterous, because if she were in the business of avoiding tough fights and being protected, she would have never went up there to lightweight and fought Katie Taylor. She could have stayed right down there at 130 and her O would have still been intact. But she so chose to take on that challenge.
She really didn't have to.
Because Katie's up there at 135 and Eva campaigned at 130. So it was a risk that Eva chose to take on. She didn't have to take it on. If Eva Wahlstrom were in the business of protecting her O and circumventing risks, she would have never went up there to fight Katie Taylor, because she was under no obligation to do that. But that's what she chose to do. That's what she chose to do because that's the kind of fighter she is. And it's important to note that. It's important to take stock of that at a time where that Amanda Serrano fight is ever so fucking elusive. When it came to Eva, they offered her the fight. She took the fight.
No problem.
One and done.
No fuss, no muss.
I mean, I really feel that Eva Wahlstrom's gotten a bad rap as of late, and she doesn't deserve that. She doesn't, you know? She really doesn't. If Eva Wahlstrom were the kind of fighter that were protecting her O and looking to circumvent risks, this, that, and the other, she wouldn't even be looking at defending her title against Michaela Mayer. She wouldn't be looking to defend her title against Terry Harper. These are dangerous opponents. Two of the most dangerous young up-and-comers climbing the ranks in the super featherweight division. If Eva Wahlstrom was in the business of being a protected fighter, she wouldn't be looking at them. You know, with those two fighters, Eva Wahlstrom would be running risks, bigger risks than the risks she just ran with Melissa St. Ville, with Ronika Jeffrey, because those are two good fighters. They're solid fighters. But neither one of the two packs the punch that a Terry Harper does. Neither one of the two packs the punch that a Michaela Mayer does. The risk you're running with those girls, especially when you're an aging fighter, an aging champion, the risks you're running with Terry, the risks you're running with Michaela, the risks you're running is the risk of being knocked the fuck out, because they've got the power to do it. More so than Melissa St. Ville, and more so than Ronika Jeffrey. They're both solid fighters, but they're not the biggest punches. These other two girls, they can really crack, and they can really hurt an aging champion. An aging champion like Eva Wahlstrom. So if Eva really were the kind of fighter who ducks people and avoids risks, or is somehow protected, I don't think she'd be looking at two girls that could knock her out. I don't. Now, in regards to those two fights, you know, I'm a fan of Michaela. I'm a fan of Terry. I'm a fan of Eva. So in that way, I don't have any preferences. I don't have a bias.
I'm not against either of the three.
Like all of them. But at the end of the day, the truth is that with either one of those two fighters, either one, Michaela, Terry, Eva might go out on her shield. I think so. Those are dangerous fights with dangerous fighters who have sharper reflexes, snappier punches. I mean, at this point in the juncture, for Eva Wahlstrom, who's an aging veteran and an aging champion, time just isn't on her side. Not in all the ways that it needs to be. You know, with Michaela Mayer, you're fighting a statuesque fighter, very statuesque for the super featherweight division. And this is a fighter that can box on the outside and rumble on the inside. Packs a mean right hand.
Right
with Terry Harper, it's more or less the same issue, except I dare say that Terry packs a bigger punch than Michaela. This is one of the most concussive young up-and-coming prospects I've seen so far climbing the ranks in today's super featherweight division. And You know, this might be the fight that Eva retires on, because I just can't see her getting dropped or stopped by any one of these two fighters and continuing on. Not for a fighter who's in her late 30s. I just don't see it. So, you know, overall...
My take.
I think it's exciting news. I think it's gutsy. It's ballsy. It's a testament to the kind of fighter that Eva Wahlstrom really is, in spite of what some people would have you believe. I think it's gutsy. It shows real quality, real character, that Eva's looking at these two fighters for a fight. That early next year, she plans on fighting at least one of them. It shows what kind of fighter she is, but it also shows that she's on borrowed time, because I don't have Eva winning a fight with either of the two. In other news, something that may have flown largely under the radar, and I mean largely, way below it. In the midst of all the action, all the excitement, all the big announcements about the fall lineup, you know, what the Zone's got going on, PBC's got going on, Top Rank's got going on, all this different stuff. In all the excitement, it seems like nobody noticed that the WBC pulled a fast one on the boxing community, but more immediate, more relevant to the subject, pulled a fast one on Yordanis Ugas. You see, Yordanis Ugas' last fight was against Omar Figueroa.
Remember?
On the undercard for the Pacquiao-Thurman fight. Wasn't that long ago. What, month, 2 months, something like that? Wasn't that long ago?
In July.
Yordanis Ugas fought Omar Figueroa in what was announced as a WBC eliminator for a mandatory slot against the WBC champion, whoever that might be. Now, at that time, the WBC champion was Sean Porter. But at this point in the juncture, the WBC champion is Errol Spence. So one would think that that would make, you know, Yordanis Ugas the next guy that Errol Spence is about to fight. It being that he's not participating in a unification fight, we know he's not fighting Manny, and we know he's not fighting Crawford. So one would assume that, okay, well, this guy's going to take care of his mandatory because we already know who it is, and that has already been decided. And yet, we're seeing that Spence is going to be fighting Danny, right?
Danny Garcia.
Oddly enough, you know, Danny Garcia is currently ranked at number one in the WBC's ranked standings, but why is Danny Garcia ranked at number one?
The fuck did that happen?
Why is Danny Garcia ranked at number one and Yordanis Ugas is ranked at number two? I don't understand this. Danny's last fight
was in April.
The last time that this guy was in action was in April, and he hasn't fought anybody since then. So what's he done from April till now to end up ahead of Yordanis Ugas? Yordanis Ugas, who was in action not that long ago.
In July.
So how does one reconcile these ranked standings? How do you explain Danny Garcia ending up in the number one spot of the WBC's rank standings when he's only had one fight this entire year? The Adrian Granados fight. As it turns out, that's going to be his only fight for the entire year of 2019. That's the way it breaks down. Yeah, because the Spence fight, that's supposed to be going down in January, but, you know, January 25th. That is the date that they have set aside for that fight. Okay, that means that Danny Garcia only had one fight the entire year, and it was against Adrian Granados, who is a tough kid, God bless him, but he really hasn't done a heck of a lot.
No.
At 147. Certainly not enough that beating him should get you a number one spot.
No. No.
Whereas, you know, in the case of Yordanis Ugas, Ugas fought Omar Figueroa, who was undefeated. You know, he was undefeated. Ugas took that guy's O. And it was Ugas's fight with Figueroa that was announced as a WBC final eliminator. Not Garcia versus Granados. Yet for some reason, I don't know, and I don't understand it. Ugas's fight happened much more recently than Danny's fight. Danny's fight was in April. Ugas's fight was in July. You know, Ugas fought an undefeated guy at the weight, whereas Danny, you know, he fought Adrian Granados, guy with six losses. I don't get it. Why is Danny at number one? I'll tell you why he's at number one. To accommodate the winner of Spence versus Porter, and we all know who the winner is. Errol Spence. By all rights, it should be Ugas that Spence is fighting since he's not going to be unifying with anybody. But you know what?
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 Ugas doesn't have Danny Garcia's name. Say what you want about Danny's fighting skill, his resume, what have you. Danny is a more familiar face to the casual fan than Yordanis Ugas is. So even though rightfully it should be Ugas that gets a shot at those two titles, they're going to give it to Danny because he's more familiar. And they're going to dress it up by giving Danny a cushy number one spot that, by all rights, he doesn't even deserve. And this denotes two things. One, it denotes what I'm always telling you about. The WBC manipulates their own rank standings on a regular basis to accommodate whatever fights will bring them the biggest sanctioning fees. The WBC knows, like I know, like you know, that Danny Garcia is a more familiar name, a more familiar face than a Yordanis Ugas, and they figure that they could get bigger sanctioning fees out of a Garcia fight than they can out of an Ugas fight, even though they themselves are the one, that they're the ones who approved Ugas' last fight as a WBC final eliminator. But guess what? They haven't ordered that fucking thing yet, have they? No, they haven't.
No. Nope.
And instead, we're seeing Danny Garcia ranked at number one, holding a silver title, same kind of silver title Dillian White used to hold back when they didn't want to give him a shot. I don't know, make of it what you will. But whatever, we see Danny's ranked at number one, he's fighting Spence next, and Ugas is ranked at number two. Ugas has fought two times this year. Danny's fought once, the whole year, he's fought once. And it was against Adrian Granados. That gets you a number one spot? So like I said, this denotes what I'm always saying about the WBC and how they manipulate their own rank standings in pursuit of the biggest sanctioning fees they can get. Whether it's ethical or not, that's what they do. And the second thing this denotes is how, you know, in many ways, they're working in tandem with the PBC and accommodating whatever the PBC's bottom line is. PBC's very much determined to turn Errol Spence into a marquee fighter, a pay-per-view attraction. And that is evident in the matchmaking here, because all of a sudden, Danny Garcia wants an Errol Spence fight. All of a sudden. Cool, whatever. Well, let's put it this way. A Danny Garcia poses less resistance, I should say, for an Errol Spence than a Yordanis Ugas. You know, styles make fights, and it's not that Danny's a bad fighter. He's actually a very good fighter. But there are certain areas that he's lacking that Errol Spence can very much capitalize on, whereas in the case of Ugas, Ugas is a big welterweight the same way that Spence is a big welterweight. Ugas knows how to be nimble, mobile, light on his feet, the same way that Spence knows how to be light on his feet. And Ugas isn't necessarily an overly aggressive and flat-footed kind of guy. No, this is a guy who can box from the outside if he so chooses. He can fight on the go. He can stick and move. Whereas Danny, you know, Danny's got his virtues. He's got good counter punches, strong kid or whatever. You know, he's got a great chin, good power. But at the end of the day, it's not as hard to get to Danny as it is to get to Ugas, because Ugas is going to fight on the go, whereas Danny, you know, he's kind of right there. He's kind of a sitting duck. He's not that fast on his feet, and he doesn't have the fastest hands. So one can look at these rank standings and make the inference that these rank standings have been manipulated to accommodate Errol Spence in the event that he wins the Porter fight, which he did, and now we're seeing that Danny wants to fight him. I mean, you know, it looks like what it looks like, folks. That's what I'm saying. It looks like what it looks like. At minimum, if nothing else, if nothing about what I'm telling you strikes you as odd, one thing, at least one thing should. Danny's only fought once the entire year, and that was back in April. So how is it that he ends up ahead of Ugas, who's fought two times this year and last fought in July? July's more recent than April, so, I mean, Ugas really should have more ground in the ranks than that, but, you know, that's not how the WBC's got it, and I think it's deliberate. In other news, it appears that Eddie Hearn has made a request, a petition to the WBC to order a unification fight between the full-fledged WBC super middleweight champion David Benavidez and the WBC's diamond champion, Callum Smith. Now, we know that Callum holds the full version of the WBA title and the Ring Magazine belt. You know, he is the consensus number one guy at the weight. But along with those two belts, he does hold a WBC baby belt, the diamond belt. And I've no doubts that, you know, Eddie's more or less trying to use this as a segue to what could be a unification fight between those two guys. You know, Eddie mentioned that the Billy Joe Saunders fight, it's right there to make for 2020, and it's a relatively simple fight to make. And he also mentioned the David Benavidez fight and how Callum Smith is looking for career-defining fights, and that Benavidez fight is just such a fight. So what do I think about this? Well, look, I'm not going to fault Eddie Hearn for trying to make a unification fight between two undefeated champions. Why would I? Aren't those the kind of fights that we want him to make? That we want all these different boxing outfits to make? So there's no harm in him trying to take a step in that direction, trying to get the WBC involved. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just that I don't think he's going to find much success in doing so. You might remember a long time ago that the WBC, they ordered Gary Russell to fight Leo Santa Cruz, and that fight never came off. Were there any consequences as a result of that? Did either Gary Russell or Leo Santa Cruz suffer any consequences? Was anybody stripped of any world titles as a result of the fight not happening? No, but they ordered it. I remember when they ordered Jorge Linares versus Mikey Garcia. Mikey was the full-fledged champion, and I believe that Jorge was the diamond champion. The WBC ordered a fight between those two guys, and yet again, the fight never came off. Did either Jorge or Mikey get stripped of their respective WBC titles, whatever versions of them they had. Did either of those two guys get stripped of their titles as a result of that? No. And yet, you know, they didn't comply with the order. The fight never came off. So I think about those situations, and I think about this situation, and what I'm seeing is that Eddie Hearn can petition the WBC till he's blue in the face. He can do that.
But it won't work.
But it may not result in anything because, you know, David Benavidez, he's a PBC guy, and we talk about it all the time. These PBC guys, they're determined to not work with these other outfits. So you going to Mauricio and writing him a letter, that may not result in anything. It's admirable. You know, the boxing fans can certainly appreciate a promoter who's willing to extend an olive branch to the powers that be, extend an olive branch to a rival promotional outfit or what have you. A boxing fan can appreciate the effort he's putting forth into seeing such a fight become a reality or trying to make it a reality. As a boxing fan, you can appreciate him doing that. But at the end of the day, I just don't think he's going to have much success with that. So when it comes to the current crop of champions at super middleweight, of which there are four, I'd sooner believe that we see a unification fight between Smith and Saunders long before we see anything involving Smith and Benavidez. Hell, I dare say that Smith and Saunders might end up unifying before Benavidez and Plant even throw a punch at each other, okay? PBC didn't get that reputation for no reason. Not only are they unwilling to work with others when it comes to a lot of their star fighters, but they also drag their feet in making those kinds of situations, the kind of situation that Benavidez versus Plant is, to where it's a unification fight. You know, they're going to let that marinate till it's overcooked. Yeah, it's possible. It's happened before, and it can happen with them. So, you know, I admire the conviction of what Eddie Hearn is trying to do, but in all honesty, it looks like it may just be another chapter in the same book. You can keep trying to get those guys to work with you, but they ain't gonna do it. They're gonna focus on whatever they can make in-house so that they don't have to deal with you. That's how they operate, that's how they do business, and in all likelihood, that's what he's gonna say.